We were actually talking about index calculation now. We understood the construction part. We know how the decision flow goes through. And we also know how the stocks are selected. So those two slides, decision slide and the stock selection slide, we understand a high level basis, and we don't need to understand in detail specifications. But at least, let's say if I tell you, for example, Nifty 50 index or some other index, at least we need to understand that there is a listing criteria, there is a market cap criteria, there is a liquidity criteria. Maybe some sector or fundamental criteria as well there, which would probably govern the stock selection, exclusion, basically addition and deletion process. As we understand that, now we know also that how to weight a particular stock in the index, and I'm going to also touch upon that in the next slide once we finish this calculation part. So if you remember, we assume that 100 as index best value. That is what we assume. This number can be anything like 1982. This is my birth year, for example. And we can assume that this is an index value I want to start, and there is no one who can stop you, because there is no scientifically any reason that one cannot start from this index value. Essentially any index value can be an index value for us. Okay, so I keep it again back to 100, so that a number is readable and comfortable for us. Generally, that is the one criteria that goes into it, like it's a rounded number. And smaller, not too small, not too big, because if you start too big, then the problem is that you would end up having a really large number into lakhs or after a few, like a couple of decades, and then you maybe need to rebase that index value back to smaller index value, which would have some bit of impact to investors, because they also need to change their database accordingly. So generally, if you see 1,000 or 100 is a starting point for most of the index values if you see in the market. Coming back to our calculations, I think we all understand how the divisor has been divided, which is essentially divisor is nothing but an initial market cap, the first day one, 0 day market cap, 0 day. With 0 day means the day first index value that has been ticked. Ticked is as in like due to change in prices. This is the first index value for us. I hope you can see my movements, right?
Yes, sir.
Cool. So this is our first day index value, if I can put that way, or maybe 0 day index value, but let me call it as the first index value. On the first day index value, we don't have a market movements, because that's the basis I create market capitalization or my first index value. So and I have adjusted my divisor, which was a 10,000 earlier, but now I have adjusted it to the index best value. So this was my divisor, which I have adjusted to index best value. Okay, and which is why I see 100 as an divisor. It has no connection with the index value of 100. So they are same numbers, but no connected to each other as such. I mean, like, dono so dikh raha hai, to kuch confusion ho sakta hai. Or maybe let me do 500, like 200 as an index value. Okay, so this is what a divisor would be for us, 50 as a divisor, because that's how we have adjusted 10,000 divided by 200. Now I'll continue this index value for some time. We can come back to the previous one if you want. Until this point, it was pretty simple for us, because we just get the index market cap from our portfolio after the market is closed, and we divide it with the divisor that has been adjusted for the index best value at the first day, and then onwards we use the same divisor ongoing basis. And that's how we get the index value here, 254 as compared to 49. Now, just a 254 as index value has no context. But when I say 254 is a today's value and 249 is a yesterday's value, it gives me information that the market has gone up approximately a couple of percentage. And that's what I said initially, that index value in a number has no importance as such, unless it has been compared with some other index value. If there is no adjustment, your NDO market cap and NDO divisor would always be the same. There were no adjustment. You can see H column. There were no adjustment, and accordingly, not the H column, in fact, F column. There were no adjustment. Wherever there is a F, yellow color, which means that the manually value has been adjusted or changed. So until this period, there were no adjustment, and hence we have the same divisor has been used on all those basis. But as I said earlier, divisor in a layman language to me is a shock absorber. Now I will explain what I mean by shock absorber. Look at here, 13,000 was an approximately an index value. Okay, 13,000 was an index value, market cap value, and because of which we have a 260 as an index value. Now when I drop a stock and add a new stock, because of which my market cap of index has changed to 15,000, because let's say I dropped a stock of worth 1,000 crores and I added a stock worth of 3,000 crore into my index. Because of market movement, the stocks maybe that is not part of the index has gone up, and which is why 3,000 crore ka stock mein index mein I have included into my index. Now 1,000 gone out, which is 12,000 now here, 12,000. And then when I add 3,000 ka stock, it becomes 15,000 for me. Now when I use the same divisor, the problem is that my index value would unnecessarily change here. Like for example, so imagine here I have added a stock which is higher value, and I did not adjust my divisor. And imagine another situation where the next day market opened, but there were no trade happened, no trade, which means zero trade, and because of which the previous day's close value were used as the today's close value, and because of which my market cap is 15,000 only. I changed my divisor, but what I notice here is now there's a change in index value. I hope you guys are following me. Adjustment I'm trying to show, and I have made some hypothetical situation over here, which will basically help us understand the divisor adjustment. Now the reason I'm saying a hypothetical situation because my market cap after the adjustment of a new stock is the same as the next day close market cap. This is an assumption because generally something like this will never happen. But let's say the situation happened that the next day market didn't move at all, or let's say there were numerous trades but the closing price of all the 30 stocks were exactly same as the previous day. So which means my market cap of a new portfolio will be the same as my previous day adjusted market cap. This is the previous day adjusted market cap. Is the main adjustment kiya tha. Okay. Now because I haven't changed my divisor, the problem is that next day market movement kuch nahi hua. I am using same divisor. The problem is that my index value still changes. Is this correct? I mean, this signifies to me that the market has gone up by almost 15%. Is that correct? Because when I see my market cap of today's close and previous day's adjusted close market cap is exactly same. Is this correct to have say that market and 30 stocks actually went up by overall 15%? So isn't it contradicting my statement that market close prices are exactly same as previous day, and despite which I'm saying ki market index value has gone up by 15%. This is absolutely a big error. If I do that, I will be out of my job immediately next day. I mean, this is as severe as that. So what I need to do is that basically when I make a forceful adjustment to the index market capitalization. What is the difference between force? Yes, please.
Sorry to interrupt you, but what adjustment it is about?
Added and one stock drop. So what you did, you added stock worth rupees 3,000 crore, and you drop stock worth rupees 1,000 crore. Okay, and okay, yeah. So you add 3,000 rupees and you drop 1,000 rupees essentially, because of which. Until this period, the portfolio was constant. There were no changes. But after the market closed, you dropped 1,000 and added 3,000, and that has caused your market cap to become 15,000. This is adjustment outside the index market movement. These are the market movements. Change the price.
Got it, sir.
Are you with me? This is an outside index market, which outside market adjustment essentially. And if I don't change my divisor, my index value is going to cause change by 40 points. You can see here 40 points, and exactly same here can be seen, and which is effectively 15% up index value. And my statement was prices of a new portfolio, and which this is an adjusted portfolio market cap, and this market cap is exactly same because 11th ko kuch price movement hua hi nahi, and despite which what I'm saying is that market has index gone up by 15%. This is absolutely an error. If I do that, I'll be totally out of job immediately. Now, which means what I need to do is that whenever you do such a forceful adjustment, I need to adjust my divisor, the initial market cap I spoke about. This divisor need to be adjusted for a forceful adjustment. What I do simply, it's a very simple adjustment, entirely simple, nothing but what you do, just simply do that. You just identify the परसेंटेज चेंज ऑफ दिस टू आइटम्स। तो जो आपका क्लोज मार्केट कैप था और नया एडजस्टेड पोर्टफोलियो था, जस्ट आइडेंटिफाई द परसेंटेज चेंज ऑफ दैट। फॉर एग्जांपल लेट मी डू इट हियर, दिस डिवाइडेड बाय दिस विल गिव मी एन अप्रोक्सीमेटली 15 पॉइंट्स सम परसेंटेज एज एन एडजस्टमेंट। एंड नाउ आई जस्ट नीड टू मल्टीप्लाई दिस इंडेक्स वैल्यू विद माय डिवाइजर, दैट डेज क्लोज डिवाइजर। जिस दिन मैं एडजस्टमेंट कर रहा हूँ उस दिन का जो क्लोजिंग डिवाइजर होता है, आई नीड टू एडजस्ट मल्टीप्लाई चेंज विद दैट वैल्यू। दिस इज माई न्यू डिवाइजर विच नीड टू बी यूज हियर, एंड एग्जैक्टली वी हैव यूज दैट सेम डिवाइजर, राइट? सेम फॉर्मूला एफ टेन बाई बी टेन इंटू सी टेन, एंड यू कैन सी द सेम फॉर्मूला वी हैव एज वेल। सॉरी, डिड यू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट आई हैव डन इन द डिवाइजर एडजस्टमेंट? एनी क्वेश्चंस ऑन दिस थिंग?
सर, the divisor calculation will always be according to the market cap calculation, whether it is full capitalization or free float capitalization.
Absolutely. So essentially, that doesn't even come into conversation, free float or total market cap, because once market cap here, right now, the free float market cap, whatever be it, I mean, essentially, this is a just ultimately, see, terms are defined over here. Stock free float market capitalization is equal to price into shares into right of play. That comes here. Now this term is entire term, including this, yeah. This entire term is your index market cap. This index market cap goes over here, first day, which is where there is no tick essentially, because the market cap change hota hai isme. So this tick adjusted, now this, and this has to be ideally same. If you want, I can show you that adjustment as well. This and this has to be same. But what I have done here in addition to that is set this value to the index best value, because this is a one-time adjustment I need to do. Otherwise, every time I need to multiply it with this value, and hence I have avoided that. So index market cap divided by index best value, one-time adjustment gives you actual divisor now that will be used on an ongoing basis. That's how you get this data. Whenever there is a forceful adjustment, these are all the market adjustments, market changes, market price changes, which have been taken into account. And this is exactly I want to measure. What I want to measure? I want to measure market movement. And this is entirely up to this row, is market movement. Now, when I say that I am dropping a stock and adding a new stock, that means that is not a market change. That's an index change, index specific activity, because the new stock that I'm adding is already there in the market. The stock that I'm dropping was already there in the market. So the point is that I have some adjustment to my portfolio which will cause my index value to change. And in order to maintain my index value as is, I need to adjust my divisor. If I don't adjust my divisor in the same proportion, what I've done simply is, agar main ka division karke main agar ka index value leta hu na, so why I need to, and now I'm changing this value, which means I need to just adjust the difference between these two value to the index divisor, jo yahan pe dikh raha hai aapko. If I do this adjustment, my next day jab market movement mein kuch nahi hua tha, tab bhi mera index value change, I mean, like that point in time, my index value is not changing anymore. And this is correct way to do that. Understood? Now I'm coming here, divisor adjustment. I have actual now visuals for you, portfolio visuals. Let us see the portfolio. अभी ये number वो number match नहीं होंगे. The number over here, this 1000 crore, 10-15,000 crore will not match. But still, imagine yourself as a market cap over here is equivalent to this number. So the data in the I8, this is the data, is equivalent to this data essentially. So this is a day end close market cap. Close market cap, जो आपका calculation में, this is an divisor that we got from the initial calculations as such, and basis which we got this index value simply, right? This divisor is adjusted for the base value, so hence we don't need to use base value on an ongoing basis. Are we okay up to this point? Any questions?
Sir, what could be the other reason for divisor adjustment?
Yes, I'll explain those. But Do you mind if I answer this like in a couple of minutes? Basically, I want to first help understand the causes, the how the devices adjusted basically, and then I'll come to that point. And that's a very important
Okay,
point. I
sure.
will definitely, if I miss it out, do remind me. That's an important point. I'll definitely explain that. But essentially, this is normal market cap index value calculations, normal up to this level. Like, so DJO here 260 is equivalent to 18,1858 approximately. These two are equivalent to 60 here is equivalent to that. Now, what has happened here is I have made certain adjustments. So all the adjustments are added in the yellow color. And here I'm not just adding and dropping a stock, but I'm actually also making some changes to the portfolio also. This may partially answer your question, but I will actually in detail answer the question that you ask about the dividend adjustment. In this portfolio, there are some changes that I'm making. If you see, the stock B's number of shares has increased from 2 crore to 7 crore. Then stock C's preferred factor has been changed from 50% to 75%. And stock E has been dropped entirely, and stock F has been included entirely as a fresh stock. Did you understand this? All the changes, yellow marked in yellow color. I have mentioned over here action as well. I mean, feel free to ask the question. I'll keep moving slowly or in the current space I am into, and ask me a question if I'm a little faster. So this is an index value that was there, fair index value, correct index value that I calculated after the market closed. But because of these adjustments, my market cap has gone up quite a bit from 27, let's say 27.88 to 36.01. Okay, so this market cap gone up quite a bit, is it actually. And if I don't adjust my divisor, which is here in this situation, my index value is going up. This is absolutely incorrect. Incorrect, totally. If I say that just because I change my portfolio composition, my index value is going up, which means my investor valuation has gone up, then it's absolutely incorrect or fraud, for example. And hence, I need to make a very important adjustment to my divisor, which is adjust the divisor in the same proportion as the market cap has changed. I had shown you earlier. So when I divide new market cap by old market cap and multiply it to the old divisor, I get a new divisor. And when now it's a normal calculation for me to verify whether my calculation is correct. Now what I'm going to do is that I'm going to use new market cap with a new divisor, and I should get this index value. If I get this, then I'm correct. Otherwise, I'm still incorrect. Let me verify if there's a change in the decimal also. So this is a decimal to the whatever the number of decimals that are there in the Excel, it is exactly matching to that, which means my divisor adjustment is correct. Now let's see if I have done in the correct manner here. I have done here exactly right. So this is a new divisor that I have derived by applying the same percentage change to the new market cap and old market cap, and the same percentage change has been multiplied to the old divisor, which will ensure that my index value is matching now. Have you understood now divisor adjustment? Any questions on this basically? Like the logic behind divisor adjustment on this spreadsheet or on this spreadsheet, either of. So I hope you guys have understood. Like there is seems to be no question. I assume, and if there's a question after the session, drop me an email or message on LinkedIn. I'll respond to you for sure. Okay. Again, let's move forward now. Again, similar issue because of which my market has slightly gone up. Again, I made adjustment to my level. So till the time there is no forceful adjustment, till the time there is no adjustment outside the market hours. Just to answer to your question now, Miss. The idea here is to maintain the divisor, ensure the no change in divisor until there is no outside market adjustment. Market adjustment matlab hota hai ki because of price changes, whatever the change in market cap happen, that is exactly I want to measure, and hence I will not adjust my divisor. बट द डे देर इज एन आउटसाइड मार्केट आवर्स लाइक आफ्टर मार्केट आवर्स जो भी एडजस्टमेंट होती है एंड विच इज एक्चुअली कॉजिंग माई मार्केट कैप टू चेंज देन आई नीड टू एडजस्ट माई डिवाइजर. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल इट कैन बी एडजस्टेड बिकॉज ऑफ न्यू शेयर इश्यूएंस, फ्री फ्लोट फैक्टर चेंज, न्यू स्टॉक्स एडेड और ड्रॉप, और ओनली न्यू स्टॉक एडेड, नो ड्रॉप हैज हैपेंड, एसेंशियली एनीथिंग दैट इज कॉजिंग माई मार्केट कैप टू चेंज फ्रॉम द करंट मार्केट कैप आफ्टर द मार्केट आवर्स. वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, एनी मार्केट आवर के बाद में जो भी कुछ चेंज होगा मेरा मार्केट कैप में, इंडेक्स के मार्केट कैप में, देन आई हैव टू चेंज माई डिवाइजर.
So
क्लियर?
basically, sir, we can say the percentage changes after the market in the index market capital and the other one due to any reason. The
ओल्ड
same
मार्केट कैप,
percentage
बेसिकली
change,
न्यू मार्केट
or
कैप, ओल्ड मार्केट कैप, राइट?
so the same percentage changes should be done in the divisor also. Got it, sir.
एब्सोल्युटली करेक्ट. एनीवन, एनी अदर वेरिएशन और एनी कमेंट ऑन दिस? सी, दिस इज नॉट अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट फॉर यू अनलेस यू गोना वर्क फॉर अ पर्टिकुलर इंडेक्स कंपनी, बट येट दिस मे बी इंपॉर्टेंट. आई विल टेल यू व्हाई. बिकॉज लेट्स से यू गो इनटू अ फंड अकाउंटिंग कंपनी और अ कंपनी व्हिच कैलकुलेट एनएवी, और यू आर मेंटेनिंग अ पोर्टफोलियो फॉर योर पेरेंट्स और एनीबॉडी, एंड व्हेन यू ऐड मेक अ एडजस्टमेंट टू योर पोर्टफोलियो, ओके, लेट्स यू बाय अ न्यू स्टॉक एंड यू ड्रॉप, और लाइक देयर इज अ पूल ऑफ इन्वेस्टर लाइक यू, योर ब्रदर, योर सिस्टर एंड यू और योर फादर, लेट्स से योर फोर फाइव पीपल कम टुगेदर, कंट्रीब्यूट 10,000 ईच एंड यू आर मेकिंग एन इन्वेस्टमेंट फॉर देम नाउ द एंटायर पोर्टफोलियो. In order to maintain transparency in your valuation, someone is withdrawing money in between. This NAV or index value will really help you to maintain that transparency or the correct share is given to the person who is withdrawing money at a certain point in time. So this is not just an index calculation, but this can be a portfolio valuation, portfolio NAV calculation is pretty much similar like this. There are different versions also to do this adjustment, but this is one of the adjustment I'm talking about. But if you understand intuitiveness of this adjustment, then its other ones are exactly similar. Like the intuition is similar, basically. Move
So,
forward then. Yep.
that means in a mutual fund, when any person withdraws the money, so every time they have to adjust the divisor then.
No, he will withdraw the money at NAV, so that wouldn't be a problem. So mutual fund, if we withdraw money, the valuation will go down. They will not adjust the divisor still. I will tell you why. Because if I know correctly, I never been to my fund accounting team. Being in mutual fund, I mean, my profile doesn't require me to go there. But I think the way they maintain this thing is basically based on the number of units issued and the overall valuation of the portfolio. So what they do is that they let the investor who is withdrawing money out at an NAV, and whenever the valuation goes down, the number of units also go down. So this is not number of units, this is a divisor essentially. So there is a concept called units. Again, intuition is same, to not let other investors affect their valuations or their portfolio value. Because if I don't change my divisor here, I'm actually essentially saying my investors has gone up, valuation has gone up, which is not correct. And similarly, if let's say from 13,000, let's say market cap goes to 11,000, for example, I am not saying the market has gone down essentially. So let's say no change in the market here, for example. So this does sorry. It doesn't mean the market has gone down essentially. क्योंकि यहाँ पे किसी ने विड्रॉ कर लिया, फॉर एग्जाम्पल, लेट्स से दिस इज एन एनएवी कैलकुलेशन हाइपोथेटिकली, डजंट मीन दैट समबडी वैल्यूएशन हैज गॉन डाउन. इट्स बिकॉज someone has withdrawn money, but then I have adjusted divisor. There they adjusted units. When you redeem unit, you exchange it for the units. So units goes down, valuation goes down. So essentially the valuation or NAV, everything is maintained as is. So intuition is same, methods is different. So as I said, again, another method is to actually not have a divisor at all. In certain calculations, index calculation also, you can probably get rid of divisor. Essentially what they do there is, they just compare change in market cap, percentage change in market cap, and then the percentage change is applied to the index value. You don't require this column. Whenever you make an adjustment, again, you just adjustment to that. What you do is that when you calculate the next day ka change in market cap, na, you don't compare 13,000 there. You compare 11,000 as a previous market cap, because that's a new portfolio market cap after the market, and you compare with 11,000 market cap next day. If there's a change, then you apply change, that percentage change to the index value, and then you get a new index value. So multiple ways to get the similar statistics, similar data, with a no flaw as such, but depend again how the particular things are preferred by a particular organization essentially. But mostly in index calculations, this is how the it is been preferred.
Yes, sir. That is good.
Okay. Anybody else? In the interest of time, I'll move forward. Feel free to ask me the question at any point in time. So there was also a question on the total return, right? We discussed about this section so far, how the index value has been arrived and how the divisor adjustment has been made. Total return, what we do is that essentially we just add back the dividend portion to the index returns. And the way we do is that because index, whenever we earn dividend, this is dividend that we earn on a particular day. Let's say there is a zero dividend on a particular day, then it will be zero on that day as such. The T is a function, time function. So some many days you will have that total return as a zero because company don't declare dividend on every day basis or every week basis as well. So you will have a zero as a function here, maybe for most of the days, but some of the days you will have this function as a value. So once you get a total dividend value, let's say a particular day company out of the 30 stocks, one of the company has declared dividend. What you do is that you divide that dividend value, which is in INR, with a divisor value. And then you get index dividend, essentially. Index dividend is basically the dividend in INR converted to index value context. Now, form is changed from INR to the index value context. Now, this index dividend further is been added to the price return index of today. So, and when you combine these two and compare it with the previous data price return index, so essentially you get key how much return you have earned today. Let's say you bought index at this value, and because it was an X date, you earn some dividend and a price change. This is your entire return of a particular stock, right? Let's say you bought, let's say XYZ company at let's say 10 rupees. Next the stock goes up by 5 rupees, and on the same day you also earn a dividend of 2 rupees. So essentially your total return is 7%, whatever. 100 rupees, 105, and 2. Correct? So your total return is 7%. Now this is in percentage terms, and then I apply this percentage, 1 plus 7% to previous day total return index value. And that's how I get a total return index value, TR index value of a T. So this has to be superscript T typo in there. Any questions on these calculations?
So the second one, calculations, if you can give some examples, huh, that would be great.
Okay. So maybe don't go into index dividend as such. What I essentially want tell you here is let me show in Excel. Imagine you have so maybe what is the date today? So 27th 11 and 28th 11. Okay, and assume today is my working day. You bought a stock or an index, and that's this is a PR index essentially, which is a price of a stock or a price of a return index value, which is 40% approximately of Sensex. And today, end of day, it becomes 105. And dividend, this is a buying price. On this day, you even if there's a dividend, you don't earn the dividend. You earn the dividend only on the day where you hold that stock entirely, basically. I mean, the assumption here is you buy this index at the close of this thing. So you earn the dividend here too. For example, essentially your total return here is seven percent. And what I do here, let's say if my index value is 155, TR index value, some running index value was 155. And this is a previous decade index value. You see the income. I'll just do 1 plus 7 into This becomes my TR index value. Now, if you see the return between this index is 7% and for this index, pricing index, it's a 5%. Why there is difference? Because in TR index, as I mentioned, you may remember, we just capture capital gains, and here we capture capital gain as well as dividends, cash dividends. Is this helpful now? Because I will need additional data to be actually comparable and correct. So I'm slightly avoiding this information. But the crux of this index is basically you capture the price, which is a capital gain, price returns, and dividend returns. Is that helpful?
Yes, sir.
Cool. I'll move forward now. I remember there was also a question about weight assignment or whether it has been decided or assigned or derived. So one thing for sure, weights are not being decided by a particular analyst sitting in the index company. It is always derived. However, there can be some preset limits also on the weights. I'll come to that preset limit slightly later, but let me first explain you how the weights have been derived. And it's a very simple calculation again. We already understand what is the FIFO market cap. And this is the index market cap. We just sometime before we studied that as well, right? Now, this FIFO market cap of Infosys divided by this entire market cap of index market cap will give me 9.52% of it. Or maybe, for example, 180.8 divided by 24,600 approximately will give me a 0.74 as an index weight. So the size of a company, maybe total market cap or a Freeport market cap, would determine its weight in the index. Now, I also mentioned that some limits can be preset. Now, the reason we said, I'm saying about that because a particular stock's weight, a very excessive higher weight of a particular stock in the index will cause index at a risk of a particular stock price movement. So let's say a particular stock has, like Infosys has a weight of 30% in the index, which means 1/3 of the index has been consumed by Infosys itself. And there can be a risk that if something goes wrong with Infosys, my portfolio, 1/3 of the portfolio would be at a risk as well. So what I do is that in the situation, I may probably set a rule methodology, index weighing scheme, remember that slide, index weighing, there I may set a rule that the way, despite the weight being Freeport market cap, no stock's weight can be more than 15% or 20% in the index. This will help me to cap a particular stock weight in the index. And then excess weight of that stock, so typically my weight custom has to be 100%. Now the excess weight of that, let's say 30% come and 15% cap kar diya. So the 15% excess weight which I have removed from the Infosys has to be distributed to in a pro rata basis of these weights. So, let's say another stock because of a distribution, another stock which was let's say 13%, but because I gave him an excess weight of 15% goes above 15%. Let's say it being 13 becomes 17%, that 2% excess weight has to be distributed to the remaining further stocks. So this is a reiterative process in a capping. This is called cap methodology, stock capping is what I'm referring to. Reiterative process until you get all the stocks in line with index methodology, index weighing methodology, you keep reiterating the same thing. Any questions here? Okay. So what I have here is actually, this is one of the dated portfolio, but this is actual live data for certain date. I don't remember, like few years before. But this is still exactly relevant to, this has not lost any value in terms of education. And hence I haven't decided to modify this data. Now, what I mean by this is that I want to show you an example of this example with the live data. What we saw in the spreadsheet is in like hypothetical data, right? How the index value is calculated. So if you see here, now this is an index market cap. This is an actual divisor as on that day. This was adjusted, for many times due to the various reasons, like maybe new stock added, new shares issuance, or maybe many other reasons which will probably cause a change in the divisor outside market hours. This is an index value I have received. this divided by this gives me this index value. This is an actual live data of a certain few years before. Any questions on this slide? Okay, this again slide probably slightly touch upon certain reasons or certain situations where divide adjustments would be required, and there are some situations where divide adjustment will not be required. I'm going to ask you some questions over here now. I'll go pick few situations in this slide. There are some bullet points there, and I ask you questions in terms of will this cause the divide adjustments or will it not cause the divide adjustments. You, I mean, try to answer. If it helps, I mean, like, it just like help you to think more about what we discussed so far. So let me to pick stock bonus. Will it have an impact on my index market cap? If yes, it will definitely cause my market cap to change, which means divisor adjustment has to happen. So the question is, will bonus affect my divisor? So in the way you would think is like, is it going to have an impact on my index market cap? And these all adjustments are after market hours. So exactly. So if it is no, which means it will not affect my divisor adjustments, because essentially kya hone wala hai ki I'm going to increase number of shares and exactly in same proportion oppositely I'm going to reduce my price. Exactly. So for example, now will share issuance cause divisor to change?
Yes.
Change in free float factor and stock split.
No.
And reverse stock split?
No.
And the last one, rights issue.
Sir. Yes.
Sorry?
Rights issue. Yes.
Correct. And why do you think rights issue will cause a change in market cap?
Because new shares will be allotted at a specified price. So obviously the market cap,
exactly.
Cap would be.
Perfect, perfect. You exactly answered that, because essentially it's not an adjustment to the price or shares. It's a perfect adjustment to the price or shares. It's like a new issuance of a shares at a discounted price in a very layman language. So basically you're increasing the capital by issuing new shares like this, but at a discounted price. But essentially it's going to cause a change in market cap of a particular stock, and the change in market cap of a stock will cause change in my index market cap. Change in index market cap will cause change in divisor. So you, all of the questions were actually answered perfectly. Cool. So let's take another live example, how the index is constructed, like index rules. Remember that circle wala slide we discussed. So I'm going to touch upon briefly upon that. Before that, there's a quick primer on the Sensex. Sensex is the largest, 30 large, includes 30 largest, most liquid and financially sound company. Now this is a, remember, like I talked to fundamental criteria. Now, they may have some criteria which will probably ask an index analyst to first check if the company is financially sound. Now, there can be some rule book which is internet to them, but that's how they say financially sound companies. It doesn't guarantee, assures you that companies are well positioned, they are good, or they will never go bankrupt. That doesn't mean that. Index doesn't give any assurance about that. But 30 largest, market cap criteria aa gaya, most liquid, liquidity criteria aa gaya, financial sound, wo bhi ek aa gaya. We'll go, this is not an index criteria at all. This is just an attributes and index introduction. So attributes mein kya hai ki it's a free float market cap, adjusted market cap, free float market cap weighted methodology. This index is a benchmark as well as an investable index. Now benchmark because it covers nearly 45% of the market capitalization, and investable because this also have a liquidity criteria in place which will help to have a efficient portfolio management. If you have an Sensex index fund or ETF. This is the oldest equity index with history of more than 30 years, in fact now almost 40 years. The index covered 45% of the market capitalization of a listed BSE universe. And index has a 10, represent all key economic sectors, all 10 key economic sectors of the BSE sector model. So it's a have sectoral balance, it's a larger coverage, it has a liquidity criteria. So let's see how the index has been built upon. So this is actually a snapshot, a very brief version of the index that they have on the webpage. Another important aspect of a particular index being transparent or a good quality index is that their index methodology is publicly available. Because unless index methodology is publicly available, it is difficult for an investor to anticipate, understand the index methodology, and also anticipate a particular stock to be added or dropped from the index. So If you have public methodology document, it's an always a very good index provider. Coming back to the index methodology, universe of a BSE Sensex is a BSE 100 stocks, all the constituents of this index. Then out of which you select the stocks by top 75 by total market cap and top 75 by free for market cap. And then you have criteria where you include 98th percentile of liquidity. So you sort the company basically descending order of liquidity, and then you include stocks up to 98% liquidity weightages. The index also have a criteria which says that the minimum weight of a stock in the index at the time of inclusion should be minimum 0.5%. So a stock very small in the index with a weight less than 0.5% cannot be included in the index. And in order to avoid stock churn, they also have a buffer, which is like, let's say stock 30 stock, let's say, goes to 38 rank, they will still not drop the stock from the index because it's into a buffer zone. Why this buffer zone is created? Because many times stocks do deviate from their natural ranking to a higher or lower rank, and then over like a couple of quarters, a few quarters, because this could happen because of a couple of quarter bad earning or very good earnings, and over the period they can fall back to the natural rankings that they have, and which may cause unnecessary portfolio turnover to an index essentially. And in order to avoid unnecessary turnover, they have decided to have some buffer zone so that excess addition and deletion to the index can be avoided. Any questions on this? Forward. So once the index is created, this is how the portfolio would look like. Like this is a top 10 stocks for you. Their weightages, there is no capping mechanism over here. So this is how you will probably see the weight. This entire data is hypothetical. Don't probably think that this is probably not correct or something. And this is sector weight. Now you would see financial is really heavyweight to Sensex. Yes, that's correct. But if you see Indian market capitalization also, a really excessive weight as compared to any other sectors in the index. And with top 30 stocks, you have a lot many financial stocks coming into index, like HDFC Bank, ICICI Bank, HDFC, or Kotak Mahindra, Axis Bank, State Bank. So nearly half of the portfolio in top 10 is your financials. It's going to happen like this. Oh, okay. Any questions so far in the entire presentation? Cool. Seems like we are all good. Either I was able to effectively communicate, or maybe I was like disastrous to communicate. So either of these things, not in middle probably. But let's move forward. Let's see what I mean here. Power of compounding. What is a lifetime high index high of a Sensex index? Any guess? Now this is a guess question. So someone has to speak. Maybe a couple of guys can speak at least. And it's very different if I'm not wrong. Any guess? Sensex I'm talking about.
42.
Right. So not 42 actually, but it's a 44,000. This was 42 was correct until like a 1 month before, but now we're very over last 1 month, it has crossed 44,500 approximately. But now what I want is, and this is more important question for you, to guess the TR index value. Now I'll give you some information on this thing. Dividend earning generally is about 1.5%. That is called dividend yield. Like about 1.5% annualized yield is there. And this index has been there for like 1996. Since 1996, the TR index has been computed. Now I want you to think it's a more of a random guess, but some intuition has to be there. What would be the TR index value for this index? Like 44,500 here, PR index value. And we add small portion of capital gain, dividend earnings here. So what would be the index value for Sensex TR index?
Approx 60.
Since you guys are okay. Anyone else? Cool. So I have two screens actually. I couldn't notice who's commented on 60 as the value. Any reason that you thought that 60,000 approximately would be the index value?
What was the
intuition?
Sir, you said 1.5% as dividend yield, so I just thought about it like that.
Okay, but that's a very small portion, right? And the Swing 60s will almost 30-40% higher than the current index value.
Every year it is being compounded.
Right, correct. So let me show you what is the index value. The day it reached almost this value, that was in the high of 65,700, and that's the small cash dividend that we earn. But and there are assumptions here that you reinvest that entire portion of dividend back to the same index. That's an assumption in the TR index essentially, and that's how you earn that dividend portion earning. Like imagine it has almost gone to 1.5 times. Power of compounding. I wanted to talk about and I want to make a very important case over here that you need to ensure that whenever you compare your portfolio or a portfolio when you compare a particular mutual fund scheme or anything with an appropriate index, remember always appropriate index is a very important term. You can compare Sensex and appropriate index, but appropriate index cannot be spared. Appropriate index has to be there. Let's say you compare a banking portfolio with a Sensex, it's in a certain context fine, I guess. But it is not fine if you don't have a banking index in your portfolio comparison, basically in your comparison chart. So you need to have a banking portfolio with a comparative banking index, and maybe you can also add any other index that you want, but you cannot spare you cannot not have banking index or a finance index into your portfolio comparison chart. So that's appropriate index is important. Equivalently important is because your portfolio is expected to earn dividend as well, right? Now you may not have earned dividend at that point in time, but still there was a possibility that you could have earned dividend. So you need to always use a TR index value when you are comparing with a particular other index performance or portfolio performance. So now you remember, you would understand that why I use TR index value entirely in that slide, the heat map slide. Is that clear? There is no comment. I hope it is clear. So I just reiterated the same thing again, because if you don't use TR index value, you would look bad in front of your manager. Or maybe if your manager asks you to use a Sensex index value without much justification, then he doesn't have that information probably, that there is another index called TR index for every index. Every index would have two versions. I'll move forward with another concept which I want you to remember. Here, the communication was TR index, there's significant impact because of the power of compounding. Appropriate index has to be used whenever you compare. And what was the third one?
We compare TR index value. TR index.
Right. So this is how the TR index, this is, imagine now, both of these indices have exactly same portfolio, including weightages, sectoral, everything is same. Both index has the same portfolio, not even a decimal or smallest decimal change also in either of the portfolio. It's despite that you see a difference in the performance numbers, right? I'll move forward now. Here I want you to comment which index is outperforming, which has done good performance. Come on guys, someone, there are 30-40 minutes, I guess. We have about 20 minutes to finish this session.
Triple A.
Triple A, sir.
First one, sir. Triple A.
Right. I totally agree with you. If I didn't have this chart, now both index value are exactly same. Both index value, the performance, if you see from here to here or wherever in the middle also, is exactly same. But still, the results are different in the both charts. Still, results are totally different in the both the charts. The reason being, this index value doesn't start from the same starting point. Now, I'll back this argument with the data. Do I have it? You know, I have it here. So this is a AAA index and this is a BBB index that you have. Both of them start at a different starting point, and their ending is here. Okay, but when you compare, rebase them now. What do I mean by rebase? Which means they have both starting point, same starting point, like 1000. You see the chart over here. This is the this chart come from this data, and this chart come from this data. Okay. Now when I you can see Excel, right?
Yes, sir. We can
yes,
see.
Sir.
Cool. Now when I see replacing, which means essentially nothing but every day ka return nikalta hu main. So what was the return between these 2 days has been added to this index value. Percentage change in this index values is been applied to this index value, previous index value, and that's it. As I said again, 11,000 and 7,000 doesn't have any importance individually. 11,000 compared with 55,000 is relevant, and that's, I haven't lost that relevance here. So if you see here, if I show, so this has become almost 5 times. This has become almost 5.56 times. So now decimals can be a difference. Someone may have a doubt about that. Let me show you all the decimals and also show you exact difference in case anyone still has a doubt. Okay, there's small difference for some reason, but you can see the number of zeros that there already, right? Which means virtually no difference. This is exactly matching. So essentially, I haven't changed the return trajectory of this index. What I just did is that I just replaced them. I'm comparing their performance on the same chart, same starting point. This is the index that you see in the presentation. So next time when you compare a particular stock performance, let's say you compare Reliance performance with Sensex, ensure that the Reliance price and Sensex price have no relevance. Even if you reverse them, they are still the same thing. So you need to revise them for sure. Sensex, maybe let's say whatever the 1,000 as a starting point, and Reliance also 1,000 starting point, from whatever number you start with. But when you ensure revising is done, and I'll share this spreadsheet with you all guys also, so that you understand it personally. Right now showing digitally is probably okay, but you may not probably comprehend entirely what I mean to say. But when you see this formula, I mean personally you would probably understand in more detail. I want you to definitely remember this thing. You cannot afford, after this session, you cannot afford to make a mistake like first chart. This is a total mistake, and I have seen in a big consultancy firm also that some people has plotted some chart like this. That is fine. Maybe they never had a opportunity to work with someone who understand this point. Nobody told them something like this. But remember, you cannot have this chart. This is a total incorrect chart. Okay. Okay. So I think from the indexing perspective, I'm done at this moment. Do you want me to recap, or you want me to just quickly cover up this session, this section? Or maybe you can ask some questions also. I have a separate session for the question answer as well, but maybe like a quick, maybe a couple of questions I can take if you want before you forget anything. I'll move forward. This is a digital one, so I will not probably wait for long, but since there is a pause, I will move forward. So there's a style of investments and on a high level basis, these are the two broader styles of investing, which is an active style and a passive style. Now, what do I mean by active? Any comment on the active investments and passive investments?
Sir, actively the fund manager manages and reshuffles the portfolio is a active fund, like a active style of investing, and passively it would be investing into the index.
Absolutely correct. So essentially active manager chooses stocks or a sector that he want to invest into it. That is based on the research. The idea behind choosing a stock is basically he want to participate in a particular stock growth and outperform the market. What do I mean by market is like Sensex, BSE 100, BSE 500, or particular, let's say if he has a portfolio which is sectoral portfolio, energy index, healthcare fund or energy fund or banking fund. Then you want to outperform that particular benchmark, banking fund or healthcare index, or those benchmark you want to outperform. However, what happens is that he has a, because he does a research and he is kind of a committed, at least committed, I would say, I won't say like he assures us higher returns, but he is committed that he would give us a higher returns or he will beat the index. He charges a higher fund management cost. And generally that style of fund management is not transparent. Like I can assure you, like any scheme that you look on the public forum, mutual fund scheme, for active schemes, you would not have a methodology of a stock selection. Have you ever found any methodology as such? I would say no, because the problem with that is he would be fearing is that his methodology will be copied and some other funders would also take the benefit of his research or his capacity or his rules that he has created to outperform the market, right? So he would not have a methodology publicly available, which makes that investment style less transparent. Now passive, it's different. Basically here the assumption for a passive investor, the assumption here, just a second, I'll change my earphone. It was hurting my ears. It's been a while I had that in my ear. So in passive investing, investor actually believes that investment, stock market is zero sum game, and that's actually factual information, right? Stock market is a zero sum game, and which means he also believes that you may probably outperform the market at a certain point in time, but consistency of outperformance may not be possible over a medium to long term, and your investment is not for a short term, like 1 year, 2 year, 3 year basis, but you look to invest for a longer term. And then if that is the case, then probably it doesn't make sense for you to go for active schemes. Now I'll prove that this is correct philosophy in a couple of slides with some data backing as well. So what he do, like he actually then essentially invests into doesn't just pick a stock or sector as independently, rather he invests into a entire market. Like Sensex, which cover nearly 45% of the market, or BSE 100 or BSE 500 or something like that. His basis of investments is a diversification through different asset classes, and his expectation about the future performance of asset class, not a particular stock or sector. So as an investor, if he is expecting that a particular asset class would probably underperform drastically, he may probably choose not to be in the part of in that particular asset class. But he doesn't go in microscopics with the microscope and identify a particular security or a stock or sector that will outperform, because that's not his belief. Is he believes into particular entire market investment. So for him, the idea is to participate in the growth of a market or economy in general, not like a growth of a stock or a sector as such. And for to do that, what he does is he just replicate the index. I think somebody mentioned already that index in he invests into index. If this is exactly repeating in the index or replicating the market, what does this mean? Replicating the market means essentially he buys exactly same portfolio, but just buying the same 30 stocks doesn't suffice, because if you have different weight in the index and different weight in the portfolio, still there is a great amount of a chance that you may end up having a different performance than the index. So in order to ensure replication to the fullest, what he does is that he replicates the index in a composition as well as weightages as well. So let's say he has 100 crores to invest into a particular index. He will invest entire 100 crore into 30 stocks in the same weightages. Remember that slide, weightages slide I showed you, in the same weightages as the index weight is, he will invest into in that way. Now, since there is no very celebrity kind of fund manager who is promising us outperformance of the market, generally their cost of fund management is very low. They don't need to really spend a lot of money on the research as such. What they generally do is that they just replicate the index. Once they understand the index liquidity aspect, I think they're comfortable in general, and then they just license that index from a particular index provider to so that they can use that index composition and weightages to their portfolio, and which really drastically reduce their cost of fund management. Now, if I can put this some numbers behind this cost, a difference between the cost is like active fund can charge you anywhere between 1% to 2.5%, whereas a passive fund would charge you anywhere between like a 10 basis point, which is a 0.1% to a maximum of 1% approximately. So there is a drastic difference, nearly like a 1.5% difference between the both the schemes, and that's also a big difference, and this linearly 1-1.5% difference we already saw, right? When we saw Sensex index and Sensex TR index, we saw the difference how it is causing you the compounding returns over a long period, and that is where the passive investing is getting a lot more importance now. Another important benefit of a passive investing is transparency and objectivity. So if you see the passive investments, because it is investing directly into index composition, and every index has a methodology document publicly available, and index values also publicly available, and index portfolio also publicly available, because as per regulations, it is mandatory to show daily portfolio. So what is the benefit of out of this is, like, I know how the stocks are selected. I know how the stocks are performing because index values are there. I can compare them with the NAV any point in time. And I can also see the entire portfolio, essentially. So there's a great amount of transparency in terms of the stock selection, stock investments, performance measurement, everything. How do I select a particular active scheme or a passive scheme? So in active schemes, generally, you need to see a particular fund manager's performance history. Was he able to more frequently outperform the market? Has he identified certain sectors of stocks in advance before they go into crisis? That's how I would probably select the stocks here. I would also be cautious of our expense ratio, because if he fails to identify right sectors and stocks, expense ratio should not eat up my because it's a double sword. Higher expense ratio and losses as well would drag my portfolio valuation drastically down. So I would at least probably find out the balance expense ratio rather than the very high expense ratio. In passives, the way I would select a passive fund is basis the tracking error and expense ratio. These are two primary criteria to choose a particular stock, particular fund into your portfolio for passive and active. So these are some high level benefits. Like, I think I'm pretty sure you guys are the kind of level of knowledge you guys have. I'm quite confident that you guys already know this thing, but I'll just quickly run through this slide in the interest of time. ETF, because index fund, we already understand that it's like a mutual fund. Only difference between index fund and a mutual fund is in the portfolio is a rule-based portfolio and exactly reflecting the index. Whereas a mutual fund, a normal mutual fund, active fund, they has been selected by the active manager. But ETF, there is a additional level of a difference which I'm talking about here. ETF trade like a stock, any debt ETF, commodity ETF, or equity ETF trade like a stock. You can buy and sell very easily, like a Reliance or a SPI, you can buy and sell. Basically, ETF also track the performance of a specific index that has been defined here, maybe Sensex, Nifty, or Nasdaq 100, S&P 500 as well. There are certain benefits that they bring in, the passive investment bring in for you. Diversification, because generally most of the indices are broader based and they are automatically diversified. They are low cost. We already discussed a bit of it. Generally, any passive investment ETF or index fund is a very low cost product. Transparency, I already talked about it. Objectivity and transparency is highly there. Accessibility and flexibility. Because ETF is trading real time, you can buy and sell any point in time. So it's accessible and flexible also to buy and sell at any point in time. Liquidity of ETF was an issue some point in time, but now almost entire products, ETF products actually have market makers in place which have a very tight mandate of keeping the spread between bid and ask as low as possible. So liquidity is not a problem at all, I would say, actually, especially the large ETF doesn't have any issue as such. Now, I told you, right? I told you I want to back that the active funds don't outperform the benchmark very often. And I'll back you my data now. I'm there in the two slides. I'm going to talk about that. This is a scatter plot chart. And let me first introduce you to this chart. What this chart, how do I read this chart? This looks like sometimes overwhelming to some audience. So these are the different buckets of mutual fund schemes, like large cap, large and mid cap, small cap, focus fund, multi cap fund, ELSS schemes. This is a sectoral fund, banking and financial services. And these are the global funds, international, global investing into international schemes, international stocks. And this is a fund of fund investing into overseas mutual fund companies, mutual funds. What I have done here overall is, and if you see these, all the dots, basically the circles are their performance numbers in comparison to this number. These are the CAGR numbers. Somebody is unmuted. Can I request them please mute so that no one has an issue? Okay. So this is the 3-year CAGR of a particular fund performance. So I don't have the name here, but this that doesn't reduce the value of this. So any line, so this horizontal lines is basically benchmark performance for that category. So what I have done is that for every category, I have identified right benchmark. For large cap, I have identified Nifty 50 and Nifty Next 50 as a correct benchmark. For large and mid cap, I have used large mid cap index as a benchmark. For mid cap, I am using mid cap 150 index, small cap index. Now for focus, multi cap and ERSS, I am using the same benchmark, which is Nifty 500. The reason I'm using this benchmark for all these three categories is because I have looked at their composition and they are very fairly similar to each other, like 60-70% to large cap, 15-20% to mid cap, and 5-10% to small cap. A small percent here and there would be there, but that's how it is, and that's how the Nifty 500 is also looking like, large mid small board breakup. And hence I thought of like having current benchmark for them would be Nifty 500. For banking and financial services, I'm using Nifty Bank Index. Remember, I mentioned appropriate benchmark is very important. So you would understand now, appropriate benchmarking is done over here. For global investing and FOF investing into other overseas mutual funds schemes, I'm using NASDAQ 100 and S&P 500. So this is how the performance numbers of entire active schemes in a comparison to their benchmark is. So when I say this line is here, so which means almost 4% is the performance of an Nifty 50 index, whereas many other large cap schemes has actually failed to perform. If you see, failed to outperform Nifty 50 index, only two schemes managed to outperform Nifty 50 index. Now, if I bring your attention to small cap universe, you would find that small cap index is here, which means almost 10 to 10.5, 11% negative performance. And only two schemes underperform the index. Otherwise, all the other schemes have managed to do better than the small cap index. Or maybe if you come to the multi cap, ELSS, or focus funds, majority of the schemes underperform, but there are like 30-40% of the schemes has managed to outperform as well. In international space, nobody could outperform NASDAQ, but few schemes could outperform S&P 500. This is S&P 500 line, performance line. So like approximately 15% 3-year CAGR, and NASDAQ CAGR is about 26-27% approximately, like between the 30 and 25%. So nobody could have a CAGR of 30% and 25% and 27% and above. Some mutual fund schemes, actually overseas mutual fund schemes, had a better than S&P 500 performance. So this is S&P 500 line, NASDAQ line is here. So I hope this has helped you to understand that majority of the scheme actually do underperform their benchmarks. Now, an additional insight to this is that if you see large cap schemes and multi cap and folk ELSS schemes combined together constitute your half of the AUM in the industry. So it gives me additional insight that more than half of investors actually earn less than their benchmark. Is that clear? Half of the industry, because the entire AUM is into large cap or maybe large mid cap, focus fund, multi cap fund, and ERSS together. Even if I add these two schemes also, they also further add up to that. So this definitely combined together have more than half of the AUM underperforming their benchmark essentially, which means nearly half of your investments as a entire crowd together us has underperformed their benchmark. Then the question arises, like, should I really pay such a higher expense ratio to the investor, to the fund manager? And this trend is not just in India, this trend is globally as well. Like if I talk about Canada, like you see 80% of the funds had underperformed for 1 year, or 92% for 3 year, and 97% for 5 years, 1, 3, 5. So this is consistent 1, 3, 5 for all the periods. In India, you see like 3 year performance, nearly 83% of the funds underperformed their benchmark, which is a BSE 100 year. Or 80% of the schemes is underperform their benchmark. I'm talking about only active schemes versus BSE 100 as a benchmark. So if that is the case, the question really arises, should I really go into an active investments? This PIVA report is basically published by S&P Dow Jones. PIVA stands for S&P, S Standard & Poor's, indices versus active. This is the SPIVA stands for. And they do have the same methodology being implemented in different regions that we see over here. So this is not really significant one, but I want to bring to your attention that the growth of the passive investing, especially in the equity side, has been exponential. And this is a market share of equity AUM, equity passive AUM into overall equity AUM. So when in 2015, it was just a 2.5%, it has grown to now 20, nearly 18% as of September 2020. And yeah, I think I'm done with our slides. So any questions now, please feel free to ask.
You talk about the benchmark. I have a question, sir. So what is the role of information ratio in this regard? And can you put some emphasis on like maximizing information ratio is a good measure or not?
Yeah, if you're higher than information ratio, better it is for sure. But the point again I'm trying to say here is it is difficult to have a consistently higher information ratio. Which means basically you may have, there may be a certain patches of outperformance and certain patches of underperformance. Over a consistent period, if you see, majority of the scheme actually do underperform their benchmark. And that's what the point I'm trying to make, that the passive investing, that probably makes sense because it's a low cost, it's objective, transparent, and easy to understand. You know how to calculate information ratio, right? Ratio is basically you calculate using,
yes, sir.
Any other question,
sir? Suppose our stock is dropped from the Nifty, so all the ETFs and index funds which are following the Nifty, so they would also sell off their stock, right, in that portfolio, in their portfolio.
And in fact, this is a good question. In fact, I just want to add to this point. Probably I should have had this point somewhere in my presentation. The day index drop that stock from the portfolio, ideally you should drop the stock on the same day from your portfolio as well. Let's say 28 November was the day the stock has been dropped. Now the index dropped the stocks on the closing price basis. Okay, that's how the index calculations happen, right? Post market hours. Post market hour, you only have one data point for the price, which is the closing price. So they use closing price to drop the stock. So generally what fundamentals try to do is that the generalists try to sell their holdings during the later part of the market hours, because from the 3 to 3:30, the average price of particular stock is been used to calculate the closing price. And if they do there, they have a better chance of being close to closing price. This way, they will be able to reduce the tracking error.
But sir, if they sell in such a huge amount, so that would...
I'll tell you what happened. Like, I agree completely, but there is enough liquidity in the market, and that's where the liquidity criteria also plays a very important role. Remember, I told you 1% agar free float hoga, or 100% ka agar market cap, then there would be huge impact on the weightages of a particular stock. But because now it's a free float market cap adjusted, and also liquidity criteria has been in put in place for a particular index stock to be part of the index, there is a sufficient liquidity. But still, we do face some issues for mid cap and small cap, or maybe BSE 500. Okay, the bottom stocks have a huge impact on the liquidity, and we do encounter some issues with them.
Okay, got your point.
So, sir, I just want to extend Arithro what he is asking about. So, suppose this index generally rebalancing themselves biannually, especially Nifty index. So, and it is on the basis of free float market capital. So it's very easy easy to me to predict which stock is going to exit this year. So can on that strategy I can make that if suppose so much of the mutual fund has taking the position in that stock, and if it is exiting from the market, then there will be a sharp decline in that stock price. So have you seen this kind of the strategy?
Yes, private players who employs this exactly specific strategies in their investments. So one of their activity is to ensure that they keep a track of index rebalance calendar. And before the announcement of index results, they take an exactly opposite positions of certain stocks that which they anticipate may go out of the index, and they anticipate some stocks may come in the index. In fact, there is a very strict restrictions also on index managers to ensure that no information leaked out. because this becomes a price sensitive information, as you rightly said, a lot of people can benefit out of this thing. And there are sometimes, for a short period, there are impacts. I have seen that, but that's a part and parcel of your investment. But those impacts are for a very short period. That goes nullifies. Like imagine, like a stock went up by 5% on a day, and then it come back about 5 to 6% again down the same next day. Essentially, for you, the 2-day return is almost zero, right? So a small impact for a period of time, it doesn't really matter as an over a longer period of history. So it is okay, I guess, unless you are going to redeem your money on the specific day.
Okay. Any other specific question?
Yeah.
So, sir, I want to ask a last question. So, first of all, about the index construction industry and its scope in India. And if somebody want to make a career in this index construction industry, so what are the scope for them, and what is the entry level position they generally offer, and what skill is required, and what will be the future for their career?
So index providers are very limited in India as well as globally. In fact, when I started my career, there were only two index providers, NSE and BSE. I started my career with NSE, then I moved to BSC, and then because BSC partnered with S&P Dow Jones, I had an opportunity to work with S&P Dow Jones. But when you, S&P Dow Jones and MSCI are a very large employer in terms of indexing or FTSE, but the primarily S&P and MSCI have a shop in India. Apart from that, so they are the public index providers, but there are a lot of quant companies who create benchmark strategies and maintain that. I just touched upon the simpler strategies. While they may sound, some of them may sound complicated, but trust me, there are a lot more complicated strategies, options, futures, combination of, and they create indexes out of that, an investment strategy. So I do believe there is a huge amount of potential for these things to as a career opportunity. There are a lot of private boutique firms which has a lot of analysts, like in, especially in the Bangalore, they are known as a KPO company, not a BPO, sorry. They are KPO companies. I had an opportunity also to interact with some of the companies there. Evalue Service, another company which also has a good amount of presence in Delhi. Index, INDXX is another company which has a India shop. And they do very specialized kind of indices. They don't do a simpler, because simpler one has been taken care by NSC, BSC, and S&P, MSCI. So they do specialized indices there, where the statistical background plays a really important role. An ability to understand and comprehend the complex statistics formulas would really be a great advantage for you if you have that capacity. Apart from that, I suggest Excel and Python skills. MATLAB is a good easy because they are very expensive softwares, so maybe on the job learning is a great thing. Let's say if your company requires you to learn MATLAB, maybe there you should not lose that opportunity, learn that. But Python and Excel, advanced Excel, like as advanced as possible. There is no limit in Excel, honestly. Like, I mean, even today I'm learning new formulas probably after spending 10, 15 years in the industry. But Excel is must for sure for any finance industry. And equally important nowadays is in Python probably, or some programming language. VBA is fine, I guess, but no one pays attention to VBA nowadays. But still definitely good to have than just an Excel. So I do encourage all the students who interact with me to learn a lot more such skill set. We just touched upon the equity stocks and those things, but there are a lot of future and option based indices also there. Structure products are there. What they do is the structure product guys, they use index and then they wrap it to with the different options layers, wherein also indexing skills are very important. So even in mutual fund company, insurance companies, they have NAVs there. So for me, universe is big, pretty high. I'm not just limiting myself to index calculations the way I just showed here. If you understand certain concepts out of these things, this will become a very important building block for you. Wherever you do in some career in the capital market industry, let's say someone of you becomes an advisor, for example, financial planner. You have to understand active and passive investing. What is the passive? What are the benefits of the passive investing? Because passive investing index is the heart of that. And when you understand different types of indices, then it's easier for you to comprehend the passive product and recommend to your client. So indexing is something, let's say there is a day when the stock market is going to die. That is the last day when the indexing will also die, because indexing is the most important part of the stock market. Without indexing, nothing can happen. It's not a lot more informative. I mean, like, stock market can still function. You don't need an index absolutely to function the stock market, but it loses its relevance if you don't have an index. So for me, I'm not resting to only index analyst as a career, but looking much more wider perspective.
Okay. So thank you very much, sir, for spending your time and giving your time. It's almost more than 3 hours you have spent with us. So request you to share the PPT and the Excel sheets also. So thank you very much, sir, for this very informative and insightful session. Very much.
It's a pleasure. Always fun to have students from the NISM. Like, I have always enjoyed interacting with them. The benefit is that, like, they are very well informed, and it's very easy to communicate the certain complex concepts also. Because when I go some other colleges, I reduce some bit of complexity of the presentation and just ensure on the few things that they should definitely learn out of the session. But I ensure that in NISM, slight higher level of complexity has been there, because I do believe that they can probably comprehend that. So yeah, it's always a pleasure to be at NISM. And I hope I was able to communicate enough, because this is a digital one. I had a bit of I'm more familiar and comfortable with in-person classes, but still I hope I was able to communicate enough of my slides.
Yes, sir, you are very communicative. So we are also waiting for the opening of our campus. Once it opens, we also host you in person.
Sure, sir. All right.
Yeah. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.